Let's talk about Emily in Paris and how it's making us delusional. Before we jump in, I'm drinking a Fei tea that was in one of my High Priestess boxes. Sometimes I'm sponsored by a company named High Priestess, and they're amazing. And this tea in particular came in one of my boxes. Love them. Not currently sponsored, but love this company. This tea has chamomile, jasmine flowers, red rose petals, and calendula flowers. My reading is on point today. Okay, I'm drinking it in my uncle ear. Oh my God, Britt. The start of this podcast is my tongue is twisted today. Okay, Uncle Iroh teapot. So let's see. Delish as per usual. I love it every time I have it. Okay, let's take deep breaths because obviously I'm frazzled this morning. Okay, how am I feeling? I'm feeling fine. Okay, how was your Christmas? Was it great? Mine was great. Super stressful. I had to fly home. Of course, flights got delayed. As you guys know, America was experiencing a crazy storm, and that gave me plenty of time to binge watch Emily in Paris. You guys know I did a review of the first season, and I loved it. I really did, but in a very casual, superficial way. If you haven't seen it, I will end up spoiling it for you, but I really just want to make it like a jumping off point to have the real conversation I want to have today. In life, social media is completely skewing how we see reality. TV is not far away from that. I think in TV land, we also have that problem where we're watching characters on TV and we're thinking, this must be easy. Life must be easy. These are people in their 20s to 30s who are experiencing, you know, growing up, falling in love, creating, you know, an amazing career for themselves. But the way that things happen for Emily is so freaking delusional, or I am just not a white woman in America, so I don't understand how things had just happened for her. Now, this is very important. I know there is a rumor that I am a white woman.
Yo, low-key, I did slap a white woman on camera.
Come on, bro.
No, I'm serious. Jeez. You guys can pull it up. That shit was fire, man. Shout-outs to her. Brittany Simon, shout-outs to her.
But I am obviously a Middle Eastern woman. Well, not obviously. I'm a Middle Eastern woman with immigrant parents. So I, compared to my white girlfriends, just had a very different upbringing. I had a very different experience and relationship with life, right? Sometimes people call me spicy white or kind of white adjacent, white enough, as my first girlfriend in my adult life would tell me, oh, you're white enough to date, so that's okay. And that is interesting. And maybe that's why I'm having a hard time relating to Emily. But Emily is this cute, dainty, white American who finds herself in Paris and she's in love with it and she's just being treated like an anomaly, as if the French aren't snobby enough and don't hate Americans, but in this show apparently find her charming and interesting, though at first in season one they were kind of like annoyed with her and spoke French around her and deliberately made her life hard. By season two, and even within season one, not only do all these high fashion, high powerful, very rich people want to have sex with her, but they want to, for some reason, help her. And that frustrates me because I don't know anyone who has this lived experience. Now, it's a TV show, so let's run with the fantasy of it, I suppose. But it really makes you sort of think you're a loser in some ways. And I actually find myself relating the most to the characters who are struggling the most. So Mindy, who plays the best friend and, of course, token person of color, we love this. She is a wonderful best friend, as per usual, to the white girl. And she is a heiress who comes from a billionaire family but left her family and was disowned because she wanted to make her own way. So she lives off the merits of her own work. Now, at points in the relationship, she even rooms with Emily and ends up her roommate kind of permanently. But she is her own person. She has none of the benefits of her family's ties, except in little ways. Example, she eventually ends up meeting up with a classroom friend that she knew in private school and ends up dating him. And he's very super filthy rich. And of course, that lands Emily some deals. Other than being recognized by people who knew her from her past rich life, her current life in Paris was mostly spent as a nanny and a singer. Her goal is to be a singer. She was quite one at, you know, quite famous one at some point in her career. But she's really just a bar singer now in Paris. And we love that for her. Her story is normal to me, not the heiress part, and definitely not coming from like a super wealthy family or anything like that, or being a superstar at some point. But her personality is the most relatable thing to me. She talks like a normal person. She experiences life like a normal person. She's rebellious like a normal person. Emily is not. Emily is like this weird character that's this main protagonist that I'm assuming we're all supposed to relate to, but nothing that happens to her is normal. I'll give an example. Throughout the series, all the rich, important men want to be with her, but there's no real reason. I mean, she is a beautiful person. Lily Collins is a beautiful person. But she's not a supermodel. And so I'm not sure that it's, you know, what is it there that they want? It's not that she's smart, because in the show, though she's helpful, she's not exactly a genius. She's just good at her marketing job, which everyone at the marketing firm is. So she shouldn't stand out in that regard. She's not, you know, there's just nothing about her, in my opinion, that's quite unique. So I don't know why people notice her. The only thing that's very unique about her maybe is her fashion sense, but she's in France. Everyone's fashionable. So again, why is she sticking out? Because the writers allowed her to. It's like major plot armor, right? So it frustrates me a little bit. There comes a point where they need to get an interview. Sylvie, who runs the marketing firm she works for, needs to get an interview with this very prestigious, very, you know, unattainable journalist. It's just like impossible to get an interview with her. And Emily hears her name and goes, I know that name. Oh, she follows me on Instagram. Why, bitch? Why she follow you on Instagram? Like, it makes no sense as you're watching the series why people in France, whether they were there originally or not, like this writer is technically from Australia originally, but speaks great French, blah, blah, blah. Why is this woman following Emily? She goes, Emily, it's just amazing. An American in Paris. Wow. And I'm like, as an influencer, whatever you want to call me, a YouTuber, whatever you want to call me, I'm not quite an influencer, like a real influencer, but, you know, I'm a content creator. What is unique about being an American in Paris who streams? Isn't that pretty common? Like, I don't understand why that would make Emily interesting. She has like 18,000 congruent, like, streaming followers or viewers when she goes streaming. Like, literally, she'll stream on her phone in Paris and it will show how many people are watching, and it's like 18K. I'm sorry, ma'am. Excuse me. That would make you one of, like, the top streamers for live streaming. Do you know what, 18K? Like, that's a big stream number. Like, that's not a joke. As somebody who's friends with Destiny, who's a streamer, and when he reaches those numbers, it's amazing. As somebody who watches or knows of Fresh and Fit, when they're streaming and they hit those numbers, it's a big deal. Hassan streams at like 40,000 viewers. That's a big deal, right? You get noticed. How is Emily all of a sudden just in France streaming? It doesn't make sense. She doesn't dedicate herself as much to the streaming world as her marketing job, but she uses her streaming world to push her marketing job, which is interesting because I think a lot of people do the reverse when you want to become a YouTuber, is use your normal job to boost your streaming career. But again, Emily is written by people that I don't think stream, and that's okay. I just don't love the way that it's portrayed, as if it's easy, as if famous people who are hard to reach will follow you because you're this American in Paris. Again, offering nothing unique as a person, but yet we're supposed to love her like she's the best thing ever. Throughout the series, there comes like moments where Emily is like a pushover and passive, and yet like a dominant American who asks for raises and is aggressive with people and wants to do her job and even goes really beyond her boss sometimes to get things done. And we're supposed to see this as something that's amazing about Emily, and she's so unique, and it's really, you know. Of course, as season two progresses, her other marketing friends, like her coworkers, start to feel resentful that she's not being quite a team player. She has this American way about her where she doesn't pay attention to people's feelings. She's not considerate or observant, and people feel like she doesn't care about them. And I think that's kind of accurate. Emily is an incredibly selfish person who plays the naive card every time she hurts someone's feelings. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to. Oh, I had no idea. I feel stuck because I'm, you know, I have to do something that's hard. Girl, we all gotta live a hard life. And she sits there with this naive personality, but yet is being praised as this smart and sharp American. I know these things can live together. I know that we want to pay attention to tiny contradictions, but I think it sets the viewer up, especially young people up, to think that this is life. And that's not really how life goes. Emily's don't really exist. From what I've seen, it's not as easy as just being a cute girl. You know what I'm saying? And being half good at your job. They let her be good at her job because miracles happen around her. It's not that she's actually any better at her job, right? Like, things happen to Emily because it was written into the show, not because life actually works this way. There's one part in the series that actually frustrates me the most. Gabriel owns a restaurant. He's like a chef. That's like his goal throughout the three seasons of the show. And he wants a Michelin star. So like overnight, he decides, I'm going to be a Michelin star chef. And then overnight, through connections, he's like, basically, by the end of the season, going to get a Michelin star. And I'm like, what is this? What is this? Michelin star is, Yes, a construct created by a tire company to make you feel less, but also to reflect more. And Gabriel, wonderful cook throughout the series as portrayed by his character. But the idea that Emily would know somebody at work who would be dating a Michelin star reviewer, who would take them to the restaurant, who would then, by a miracle, give him a Michelin star after he's only been a chef for like a few years, is just so obnoxiously not real life. In real life, you have to work hard for what you get, unless you are extremely lucky. And I don't know anyone who's ever been that lucky my whole life. But this is what frustrates me about the show. You are not going to end up with a billionaire boyfriend. You are not a fucking 4 who's going to end up with a 10. Like, you could be, for sure. But you are not. You would be the exception. You are not the rule. Gabriel is a young chef with less than so many years experience having his own kitchen. He's not going to get a Michelin star because he wants one. Okay? Like, that's just not how life works. So again, if you're into luck, this is the show for you. If you're into reality, I'd pick a different one. All the other characters in the show, strangely, are very real to me. I consistently forget that, like, Julian and Luke and Sylvie, who work at the marketing firm, aren't real marketing people. I consistently forget that they're not actually the people they're playing in the show. Versus Emily, she just feels like a character on TV I'm watching. She doesn't feel real to me, and it's because her story isn't relatable. We want it to be relatable, but also the fantasy, and I think that's the problem. In order for the fantasy to sort of be real, you have to hurt the characters around you who are very much written like real people. Like Gabrielle and Camille, they're a couple, but they're also people who become friends with Emily. And there kind of becomes a messy moment where Emily sleeps with Gabrielle while him and Camille are on a break. But it feels like a betrayal, right? It's a very messy situation. Emily is always sleeping with people. In season 1, she sleeps with Camille's 17-year-old brother. But apparently that's okay because they're in France. Or was he 16? He was underage American-wise. But she, like... it's weird. They're painting her as this virgin on the streets, but this woman sleeps around. And yet Mindy, because of her personality type, gets painted as kind of this like rebel slut because she is, but no more than Emily. Like Emily's less of a rebel, so maybe that's it. And maybe I'm just a little annoyed because I'm more Mindy than Emily. But I don't know very many Emilies. And if I do, I don't tend to like them because again, it's like they get painted as the good girl while the Mindys get painted as the bad girl, but the actions are the same. So maybe the package is a little bit different, and maybe that's it. Maybe. And maybe that's something we can use to reflect on. Maybe instead of being upset that Emily's could exist, though I've never met one, and I've met tons of Mindys, and I also feel like a Mindy, it is interesting to me, I suppose, that I could become an Emily, but man, I really couldn't. I'm not sure anyone should be. Kind of like Carrie Bradshaw and Samantha. Samantha is the more real person. She's more honest and transparent and much more interesting and dynamic as a character. But Carrie is the show. But maybe Carrie is the fantasy as well. As we've gotten older, fans of Sex and the City, we definitely have had conversations about how Carrie ends up being really toxic, to be honest. How we end up taking Big Side a lot of the time as we aged, or how we just wanted Carrie to own up to something, be accountable. Samantha, in her own way, owns her accountability. Mindy is accountable. Emily and Carrie rarely become accountable for their actions. And maybe that's the problem with TV shows. Maybe main characters aren't supposed to hold themselves accountable. Or maybe I just prefer shows where they do. I'm not sure. But I want to really use this show to remind us that what you're seeing on social media and in TV shows is not real life. Falling in love, being messy, everyone fucking tens, like, that's just not real life. It is some people's life. It is some people's bubbles, but it is not a majority of our lives, and that's probably for the better. These people are dramatic, toxic, liars. They need a lot of help. There's a lot of hurt feelings. In the series, she ends up dating this guy named Elfie. Super hot, super great, super wonderful, super kind and compassionate and interesting. Kind of comes off with fuckboy energy at first, but then you realize like it's just a wall because he's been hurt so many times, and you're like, Elfie, and you like love him. But in season 2, it kind of comes out that in season 1, Camille and Emily made a pact not to date Gabriel because they both liked him. But obviously, since Camille was with him first, before Emily even came to Paris, Camille and Gabriel end up dating long term. Because of course, right? Like, come on, it's TV. But Elfie ends up dating Emily and they go back and forth. They even have a breakup because it feels like Emily's not really into him. And he's the black guy. And frankly, it kind of felt like a token black guy situation. Like, he's an English black guy, which is interesting, but he's in France, which is interesting. He meets her in a learn French class, like a learning French class. And they bond sort of, mostly because he and she neg each other. But the problem is that you see Emily settling for him. You even see him sort of settling for her, but then kind of hoping she's the one, right? In season two, Emily begs him to introduce him to the family, his family, because, he goes to visit his mom for her birthday, and he comes back, and Emily says, like, what did you tell her about me? He says nothing, because in the past, when he's tried to get closer to his girlfriends, introduce them to the family, they break up with him. And Emily's like, I'm committed to you. But Emily's also lying, kind of subconsciously. She really is sort of thinking she'll end up with Elfie, but I often think she makes decisions because she thinks she should, which really frustrates me because that happens a lot. There's even a scene where Mindy is dating her old classmate. I'm looking at the cast to my left to try to find his name, and I'm not seeing it. I don't remember what they name him in the show. I'm so sorry. All right, hi. I just took a break from this podcast to literally look up this man's name, which I could not find, which I'm a little frustrated by. I don't know why it's not on any of the casting sheets. I must be looking different, but this is season three, not season two. I did not even realize. Now I'm trying to think of, like, what happened in season one and two. I must be mixing them. But sorry, I'm talking about season three right now. This is insane. I feel so bad at my job. But this is season three. I thought this was season two. Oh my gosh, this is season three. The character development is not moving fast enough in this series. I did not realize. So my bad. Okay, so in season three, Mindy is with this new boyfriend. And there's a part where him and Emily are on sort of, they have tension. And they're at Mindy's party for Mindy after Mindy already said to Emily, I need you to be here as a friend. And then the boyfriend is mad at Emily because a business deal fell through. And he basically, like, threatens her sort of to basically leave the party. And she does. And that's frustrating for me a lot because, again, is she an American that pushes boundaries and crosses her boss's boundaries, but then not her friend's boyfriend? And that's weird. But then I've met some women, some people that will make decisions to sort of forgo their own feelings because they don't want to cause an issue with the friends, right? But I think that later in the series, like, Mindy says, you know, don't do this for me. Like, obviously what he did wasn't fair, and they talk it out and they all try to make amends. And it's kind of like a healthier version of this kind of technical trope of a storyline. But the problem I have with it is that Emily is this person who is portrayed as very dominant, but also very passive. She's confusing when she chooses to be passive, but I also understand why she does it, because she's afraid. And fear is that motivator that causes us to maybe not serve ourselves so well, our joy. Fear is the road to hell. It is, you know, they say the road to hell is paved in good intentions. True, but I think it starts with fear. I'm afraid for you, so I'll trap you. I love you, and I'm afraid I'll lose you, so I'll suffocate you. Often we see people in this season three, do so many things out of fear. Even Gabrielle and Camille making more of a commitment towards each other out of fear. Camille having an affair out of fear, out of selfishness, out of resentment. There's a lot of negative energy, and I think all of us have had moments like this in our life, and I think it's so important to use it to reflect, but to keep ourselves in reality and humbled. You are not going to be a superstar overnight unless you're really, really lucky. You're not necessarily going to be famous just because you were mentioned on a famous thing or a famous person follows you. So much, at least of my career, has taught me that it's not about, you know, knowing the right people always. Sometimes it's also about having the right product, you yourself being the product. Emily is a good product, but she's not exactly worth, I think, the sacrifice that people make around her. But maybe that's the fantasy that they're selling. Maybe the fantasy is I can do not even the best and still get the most. And I think that's a really poor message to send to people. I think the realistic message is sometimes even when you work your ass off, it doesn't always work. And I know a lot of people in the past have heard me talk on my podcast, including the one I did with ABBA, and they felt like I didn't know that, but I most certainly understand that you can work your whole life and it still not pay off. But there are certain things we do in life, there are certain things we avoid and we don't even try, and then we complain. And I feel like if you're not trying, you can't complain. But I also know it's hard to start. It's also hard to believe in yourself. Emily, for all of her issues, does strongly believe in herself, enough that she doesn't want to go back to America and she wants to stay in Paris. I'm a little anxious moving to Europe where they don't really speak English. And I'm like, but Emily does it. And so a part of me admires that and wants to do it as well. I want to be somebody who's strong enough to say, I believe in myself to move to a country where I don't speak the language, or to move to a country where, yes, they speak English, not American. They speak English, but they might not want you there because you're an American. I understand that these shows are made to be a fantasy. And I'm not saying it's problematic. I'm not saying we should cancel it. I'm not that kind of a person. But I just want people to be able to watch it and enjoy it without thinking it reflects reality in a really strong way. In my life, and at least in, like, again, in mine because I'm a content creator, I find myself in love with my job. And I think I'm good at my job, but I also find myself choosing my friends and family over it. In this season 3, Emily often chooses work over friends, and it does frustrate me, but it also is something that I saw reflected in Mike's recent statement on Impulsive.
Newsflash, I'm 37, I'm a vlogger, dog. That's crazy, bro. Bro, 2 weeks from the time this episode comes out, I'll be 38 and a vlogger. Oh my. Someday I'm gonna wake up. Now, granted, I'm gonna have several millions of dollars, but I'm still gonna be a fucking, no disrespect, a YouTuber in my 40s, bro. And there's a chance that I have not gotten married on a rock.
Where he talked about how he really sacrificed for his career, but now he's alone and single, and what was the point? And it's interesting because a lot of us feel that way. A lot of us reach a really pivotal moment in our success or our career. And we wonder, but we're still alone. We come home to an empty bed. The thing that shifted for me in the last 3 years in regards to this was the fact that I, again, make relationships about consent. The idea is that you need to find someone who's going to consent to loving you and being in your life. My current partner, my forever partner, who I love so much, he and I are always going back and forth about my job. What does it mean to date a YouTuber? How do you feel if I do this for work? How do you feel if I do this for work? We're monogamous. How do you feel, how would he feel if I wanted to do a photo shoot with a girl and we were doing something for OF? Is that allowed? You look at couples like Adam22 and Lena the Plug, and him and Lena, they do porn together. They cater to a heterosexual audience. They have a brand in mind. They really like their adult work, but it is a job. I think Adam always talks about how, oh yeah, like I'm, you know, having sex with these girls, but it's work. I feel that way when I'm working. You know, I'm not always thinking about how this will play out in my relationship. Sometimes when I'm in a situation, I'm just thinking about, hey, how will this play out for views? Is this good for the audience? Is this what the audience wants? Is this within my values to give this to the audience? I've definitely had opportunities in my life where I had to turn things down because it didn't coincide with my values, often in relation to family or friends, where I had to pick and choose. One of the things I've always wanted to do is write a book about my life, but if I share certain stories, it could cause a lot of anxiety and issues for my family and friends. The world might not understand what I'm trying to say. And even if I sold 100,000 copies where 80% of my audience understood me, all I need is that 20% to be a little crazy, and God forbid I could get someone killed from writing a book. And I don't want to do that. I want to be able to tell my story without hurting people. And which is why I have a theory that I'll actually have a book in my 40s, because by then my parents will be retired, their business will be closed. I don't have to run the risk of people really finding them. Hopefully they'll be in a more rural area. But it is one of those anxieties I have as a content creator, is I would like to tell my story, but I don't want to hurt the people around me. Sometimes when I see Emily choose work over her family, I'm disgusted with her. But I also understand why she does it. Now, funny enough, and this is so weird, I don't know how much of this is trauma, but Mindy and other people like that, the people who feel closest to their family or at least are actively involved with them, are also in the most tension with them. Emily's parents are kind of these off-to-the-side characters that support her unconditionally. And so Emily kind of just gets her way every time. But with Mindy or the people in her life who have those tensions with their family, they're always in a yo-yo situation. They love them. They don't like them. They approve. They disapprove. And it feels like they want to protect their parents the most. And I'm sure this is something to do with trauma. My parents don't intentionally try to hurt me. But it is one of those things where, for me, Christmas is either a an event where someone gets triggered and we cry, or an event where we don't. This year, my siblings and I were very proud of ourselves. Not one person was triggered. 'Twas an amazing Christmas. But we love our family so much, and we are so different ethic-wise, like ethics and values and morals and like how we see the world, what bubble we live in, that of course it breeds tension. I know a lot of people during the hardcore SJW years just cut ties with their families, and I definitely did that in 2012 for about 5 years till 2018. I did cut off my family pretty significantly, but it was killing me. Not being with my family, not existing with and for them, I just didn't know what the point of existence was. Even now, I don't really love a place. Like, there's nowhere on earth that I really love. I love people, and my home is where my heart is, and my heart is with my people. So I really struggle sometimes when my family and I don't or not able to create, like, a cohesive existence together. It is a struggle, I think. Because in my head, I'm like, so do I become neighbors with you, or is that going to cause more tension? And am I supposed to move somewhere else? But I hate everywhere else. So, like, where am I supposed to go? The only other place that sounds interesting is the part of Europe where my partner is from, because his family's there. But do you see how I'm like, my brain is going to, but his family's there. So that would be a great place to move. My family's here. It'd be a great place to move. People like Emily, people who choose their careers over their family and friends, I find do end up really successful, but they also end up alone. And that is really a point of season 3, is that if you keep choosing your job, or if you keep lying, you're gonna lose good people around you. And I think that's really important. I think that's something we see in YouTuber lives, people who are constantly streaming or constantly in their job or constantly working. It's really hard to date. It's really hard to focus. There are even YouTubers I know who preach do not date in your 20s because that's your time to like build your career. I think they're right. I think, funny enough, they are right that having a job and choosing your career means less time with your family. I've been really on this lately because something I struggle with is picking work over hanging out with my family or friends. I really struggle picking up extra calls because even though I have a waiting list and people want my time, I just know I'm going to die. And so it's hard for me to choose work over my family and friends. But when my family and friends start to cut me out more or have larger boundaries, I tend to throw myself into work and I want to work more. But I also need to talk to people. I love bouncing ideas off of people. So the reason I love my job is because it gives me that. So in life, finding balance is sort of key. And it's very difficult because I think you're consistently yo-yoing. I'm in a really great place, like in a really great place in my life. Work's great. Friends are great. Family's great. I'm in love. Like everything is working out wonderful. Everything is literally heading in the direction I've wanted it to end up for years. But because we're in the middle of transition, it's really difficult to know where everything's going to settle. And I'm so excited for like February-ish because I think that's when everything is going to settle. Even my rental, even where I'm renting, my landlord needs to give me a 30-day notice. That means I have 30 days to either move state or move to a different city. If for some reason they charge me way too much for rent outside of my budget. Because the thing is that even though I'm making good money, I'm still on a very specific budget. And I can't go over it just because I'm making more money, because I need to do future things that need that money, right? So funny enough, in your career, even if you're making more, that doesn't mean you upgrade. But the world around me is charging more for just basic living. So I ran into the same problems I feel like I ran into in my 20s, except not, because I know I can pay my bills every month, which is sort of not something I knew in my 20s. I didn't always pay rent on time. I didn't always pay my phone bill on time. I didn't always pay my car payment on time. And now I get to do that, which is like a blessing. But again, it comes at the sacrifice of the family, or because my job takes me in a direction that alienates my family, I can work more, but then I don't get the family part. This is life. Life is that balance game we're all playing, but it's also so hard. I don't think life is just hard because I'm alive. I think life is hard because we all make it hard on each other. Emily makes her life hard, and I dislike her for that. But I also make my life hard, and I'm starting to dislike myself for that as well. I know what I want. I know what I think it means to be a person who's self-aware. I think I understand what introspection means, at least in my life. And I think ultimately choosing my joy is the answer. As I have believed it for 3 years, it has benefited me and it continues to benefit me now. I had a really good Christmas with my family. I really enjoyed using that season of three of Emily in Paris to kind of like bounce off things that were happening during Christmas and remind myself that I didn't want to be an Emily. I didn't want to betray my friends and family for work, and I didn't want to betray work for my friends and family. I didn't want to betray my values. But in order to really facilitate my joy, I had to really remember to keep learning myself, not to forget who I am in this present moment. Everyone's been going back and forth. All my friends and family have been really wonderful, but man, y'all got a lot of opinions about how I should do my life. Even my viewers, sometimes my callers, everyone's got an opinion on how Brittany should do things. And I get it. It's fair. And sometimes I do really need to hear other people's opinions to like maybe hear something I never considered before. But ultimately, when I sit and meditate with myself, when I talk to my partner and we reflect upon it, it's so clear what we're supposed to do. And it's just a matter of having the patience to wait for the opportunity to execute it. But the answer, I think, comes in silence. Emily is a person that when she's off work and she doesn't know what to do, she drowns herself in noise. She streams and she goes all over Paris and she distracts herself with boys and just other people's issues. I don't want to be an Emily. Emily isn't joyful. Emily stresses me out. And so in order to be joyful, a joyful Brittany, I have to silence all of you. But also I have to silence everyone who lives in a bubble that isn't mine for just a moment to remember why I am the way I am. One of the things I do during my calls with people, if they want it, again, every caller is different. Not everyone comes to me for advice. Some people just come to me to hang out. Some people just want to watch anime. But when I have a caller who's genuinely seeking a deeper, better understanding of themselves, I usually do a thing I call my core exercises, which is absolutely something I made up for myself that benefited me. And that's why I do it in my calls. But I basically have them explore that core word that is your word. So basically, if you guys want to do it at home, and it's much more like involved, but the watered down version is you need to pick a word that represents your core self that you work off of that isn't a word other people can give you. So like people would call me a YouTuber, an OnlyFans girl, all these things. That's not who I am. Those are things I do. It's not who I am. I am not an OnlyFans girl. That is not my identity. It's just something that I do. I am not a YouTuber. That is just something I do. But I can see how some people like Mr. Beast, that is his identity, YouTuber. With other people, they are the OF girl. That's like their thing. For Brittany, my core self is a mother. I might not have kids, but I'm a mother. And I need to honor that mother every step of the way, especially when I'm in conflict. I know myself, and I know that when the world is silent and I'm just with myself, I just want to take care of people in a very specific way. But I also don't want to suffocate people. I want to kick them out of the nest eventually. I'm the kind of mom that doesn't want you to be with me your whole life. If you're a caller of mine and we have that dynamic where I'm someone you're coming to for help in a philosophy way, then I'm going to kick you out of the nest eventually and have you go on your way. My calls are not an opportunity for us to date or become best friends. In most situations, it's an opportunity to talk to somebody else, to gain tools, and to move on with your life, right? Know yourself well enough so you can facilitate your joy. The path to that is going to be specific to you. You can use the path I took and see if it works, but it probably won't exactly work for you. But hopefully there will be parts of it that does work, and then you can just get rid of the rest. It's not one way fits all, right? It's not one size fits all. It's not my way or the highway. You are a unique individual, a very special person in the universe. And though you are like many people, as am I, no one is quite us. And so you really got to create and facilitate your joy through a path of your own design. Emily is a person that I find frustrating because she has a tendency to be rebellious, but then she isn't. Mindy is. Mindy's not our main character because we want to sell the narrative and the illusion, and we want to make people delusional so they think that you can just be an Emily and life will work out for you. It doesn't work that way. You have to work hard. And you don't just have things fall in your lap unless you are a very lucky person. And I don't know about you, but that's not me, girls. I don't think luck is exactly what I am, right? I think I'm just a person who gets to work hard for my whole life, and I get to get what I get what I get, right? And it's going to be good enough, like it is right now. It is good enough. But I had to work really hard to just get good enough, right? Yeah. All right. Thank you for watching. That's all I wanted to say. I just want to hit home that good enough is sometimes perfect. But if you don't find yourself feeling joyful, there are more steps to take. Emily does not have a joyful life. I don't want her life. But I appreciate that there are shows that show these people. If you feel like you're an Emily, can you guys share in the comment sections down below, what is it like to be Emily? Because genuinely, I don't understand her at all. I relate so much more to Julian or even Luke. Sylvie. Sylvie's so relatable. I don't understand Emily whatsoever. Everyone else in that show is so relatable. But Emily is just, she's just not. You know what I mean? I don't understand it. Let me know what you guys think in the comment sections down below. Thank you for watching. I hope you have the most wonderful day. I hope your Christmas was really lovely. I hope your holiday season's been great. Happy New Year. And yeah, I'll see you guys soon. Bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life while in bed, my belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed, so why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking, yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth, and living life as a fool.